presentation. So anyway, appreciate Dan, and I'll introduce him right now, Dan Peterson from HPC.
Hey, thanks, Brad. Hi, everyone. Nice to get a chance to talk to you about winter weather desk operations and verification. Wanted to give thanks to the developers that here have developed the verification I'll be showing in today's slides, Keith Brill, Dave Novak, and Chris Bailey. So I'll go ahead and go into the presentation. Brad wants this to be interactive, so it'll probably be more useful for you if you ask lots of questions. So,
can I interrupt 1 second?
Sure.
Brad, can you just give the join me code over the phone line, please? Hello?
Yes, okay. The URL is join.me/wdtb.noaa.gov. That's join.me/wdtb.noaa.gov. And I'm just going to keep that up and active throughout the thing. Okay, go ahead, Dan.
Okay, great. Thanks, Brad. Ask lots of questions as we go along. Interrupt after each individual slide. I'll ask people for comments as we go along, but don't feel need to be prompted. Go ahead and ask whenever an issue comes up that you want to discuss with me, okay? Here's the presentation outline. We're going to cover the recent changes in our winter weather desk operations, and in addition to the operations changes, verification of last year's summary, and also we're going to cover operational changes on other desks besides the winter weather desk. For the last couple of years, we've been developing an increased suite of probabilistic forecasts, and traditionally what we've had are the probabilities for 4, 8, and 12 inches of snow and a quarter inch of ice, and those are shown in the upper right portion of the screen. And what we've done is expanded the suite of probabilities so that we now have probabilities for snowfalls low 1 inches and 2 inches and also as high as 18 inches for the first 24 hours. And then for freezing rain, they're as low as 0.01 and as high as half of an inch of snow. And so in the lower right, you can see what I call the continuous probability forecast. And so you can see the scale at the bottom ranges from 1 to 100. So instead of just the three contours, you get all the possible probabilities. And then those forecasts use the HPC deterministic accumulation forecast as the mode and combine it with all the ensemble members to generate a draft set of probabilities that we edit and make our finals. Let's see if I can get the pen to work here so I can annotate a little bit better than I had been. There we go. Okay. And so in the lower left, you can see the KML depiction of our traditional probabilistic forecast. And so those are available on our webpage for both the accumulations and the probabilistic forecasts. We'll go over those. And so and then these continuous probability forecasts in the lower right are available on our webpage. Okay, any questions about the evolution of the probability suites before we go on to other products? Okay, none heard. And so here's an example of the KML file displayed in Google Earth for the accumulation forecast down in the Intermountain West. And so the web page at the bottom of the screen shows our internal site and where you can find the archive of all last season's products and then all of the products we've had so far this season corresponding to all of our forecasts. And so the archive is available for anybody in the Weather Service to use. A lot of people at conferences last year told me they were using these for decision support briefings. That's what they're there for. And so it's up to your discretion how you use these, whether for internal coordination or if you want to share with emergency managers and other partners. That's at your discretion. Okay, any questions about the KML files? Okay, none heard. And so here's what I call the continuous probability forecast. We developed the original draft version 2 years ago, where they had the 24-hour forecast, and so you can see the panel of 24-hour forecast probabilities there on the left, and then in the past year, we've added the 48-hour probabilities first for snow and then for freezing rain. And so since 48 hours is a longer time period, you need to encompass more options, and so we start at 2 inches, and then we go up to 30 inches plus for the heavier, longer duration events, and then you just choose which day combinations right there on the right that you want to go with, and then the forecast displays. And so these forecasts are available on this web page shown at the bottom of the screen. Okay, any questions on the 24 and 48-hour continuous probability forecast? Okay, none heard. Let's go on. For the operations desk for this winter, we use an accumulation blender that is shown on your screen each day to compose the forecast. The options that are color-coded in green are our QPF, and the color-coded in the light blue are for precipitation type. So for this year, we have an option of the nested NAND QPF, and we also have an option for the nested NAND precipitation type and also for the UK Met. The UK Met only comes in 6-hour increments for days 1 and 2, so we don't have that for the day 3 forecast when it's been one big chunk of 24 hours, and we can't tell how long the precip type is rain or snow or mixed or going back and forth. And, of course, the nested NAND, which is the 4-kilometer inner grid, is only run for days 1 and 2. Any questions about the options of the models and ensembles we use to generate the accumulation forecast each day? None heard. And also for decision support briefers, the weather service liaison, the FEMA, had requested a contiguous U.S. view. This is the winter weather desk internal page. And so once this option right here for CONUS is chosen, then you display the image for the whole country. And I requested that there still remain views for the Intermountain region and then another one for the non-Intermountain region. And so if anyone wanted to save the image for a presentation, you would click on the show option at the top, and a separate window pops up, and you can right-click and save or go ahead and copy it into another forecast. And the option right down here shows you the link. I had shown you in the previous slide, the GIS format forecast. And so you click on there, and that brings you to the page in which you can call it the GIS forecast. Also, we have the day 1.5 accumulations and the day 2.5 accumulations for the intervening 24 hours. And so the day 1 forecast is 12 to 36, so days 1.5 is 24 to 48 hours. And so on the day shift, that would be a 12Z to 12Z period, and on the night shift, 0Z to 0Z. And so you get just a wider selection. But at this point, I hope all the forecast offices are ingesting the grids that are provided through each of the regional headquarters and displaying them in your D2D and GFE. Okay, any questions here on either the internal website changes or on the availability of the gridded forecast?
Yes, this is Brian in Midland. We just had a brief power outage. I didn't quite catch the first part. You say those grids are going to be available in GFE?
Yeah, and so we've been working the last couple of years with Joshua Watson in Eastern Region Scientific Services. I gave him all the deadlines, and we give him all the data. We FTP, and he distributes them to each of the regional headquarters in the Weather Service. And so contact either your regional representative, Midland, that would be Southern Region, their scientific services, and see if they can give you the scripts that will ingest the data and put it into both D2D and GFE for use at your local office.
Okay, so we're going to contact the regional headquarters. Okay, thank you very much.
Yeah, sure. Glad to help.
Hey, Dan, I had a question. This is WFO Fairbanks. I was curious if you guys have any intentions of expanding the this forecast up for the Alaska region.
Yeah, hi, this is Dan in HPC. The discussions we had with Alaska Region evolved so that we asked them what product suite they wanted us to provide, and my understanding was they had a split vote, and the winner of the split vote was the median range forecast. So we've been providing the days 4 to 8 median range forecast for Alaska as a result of the vote that they had. And so if that needs to be revisited and you would like to have that support, go back and see if you can convince them to change their minds. But that's where we stand right now. Alaska has not asked us to, Alaska Region has not asked us to provide a snow forecast right now.
Okay, great. Thank you very much.
You're welcome, and thanks for the question. Okay, any other questions on the internal webpage and or the grid forecasts that are available? Okay, none heard. We'll go ahead and move on. Of course, you can bring up any issues later on after the draft presentation is done, too. So new for this year, we've developed on our website an archive. And so this is just a mapping of the types of forecasts that you can get on the archive website. So you can look at the snowfall probabilities, the freezing rain probabilities, and the low tracks forecast with the uncertainty errors for each time period, and also the low tracks that show the little dots for each of the ensemble positions within the forecast. The website that has the archive is right here at the bottom of the page, and it's directly linked right on the HPC front page. This goes back to about March or so. If you have a historical case from earlier last winter or previous winters, I can dig up the archive forecast, and we still have the deterministic accumulation archive on our internal web page, so that remains there for all previous years for your use. Any questions on what we've developed here in the archive and what's available on internal and external pages? Okay, I figure that's pretty straightforward. So we'll summarize the plans for operations. What was experiment the last 2 years is now operational for our continuous probabilistic snow and ice forecast. And for this year, we're going to add the CONUS nested NAM at 4 kilometers to the available models and the snow and ice accumulation blender. We will still have the parent NAM as available as an option as well. And we've added the UK Met as guidance available for precipitation type. Now, keep in mind, we don't get precipitation-type grids from the UK Met model. This is being run through an old-fashioned algorithm that depends on an evaluation of the temperature profiles. And finally, we've got a new archive for all of our probabilistic snow and ice forecasts to complement what we had before for the accumulation forecast. And so that's available on this page, and it's linked right off the HPC website. Okay, I want to see if there are any questions regarding operations now before we go into the verification.
This is Bob up in Buffalo.
Hey, Bob, how's it going?
Hey, did you have the European in that last year? I don't see it listed here. Did you have it last year already?
You mean available model options in this one?
Well, I see that you have set it there, the EC ensemble.
Uh-huh.
So that was there last year?
I believe so, yes.
Okay, because you were talking about what
last year was the first time. I'm sorry, go ahead and repeat, Bob.
You were talking about what you had new this year. You were talking about the nested, the NAM nested. I assume the EC was there last year then if it's not new this year. I didn't realize you used the Euro last year.
Yeah, so this was the European ensemble mean QPF, and then over on the right where I circled it was the precip type. Yeah, that was added for the first time last year. Uh-huh.
Okay.
Good. Okay, any other questions on our operations before we go to verification?
Yes. Hi, this is Paul up in Caribou.
Hey, Paul. How's it going?
Good. Just wondering, I noticed you do have the CMC model. Is that the nested, the regional model that you use for that, or the...
I wish. It's the Canadian Global model. And so I have an outstanding request of multiple years to get the gridded regional Canadian data.
Okay.
And so we don't have access to that. I have to look at a web page to look at the Canadian regional forecast. And so this is the Canadian global.
Okay. Okay, thank
you. Yeah, sure.
Hey, this is Linda from the Quad Cities. Can we get archives right off the WWD page that has all the current forecasts on it?
Yeah, right at the top of the page is a link that says Winning Weather Desk Forecast Archive, and it brings you to this page that I listed right at the bottom. You don't have to write down this address right now because Brad is going to record the next session on Friday, and he's asked me to develop an articulate presentation that he's going to post on the web page for later on. So when you see web addresses, you don't have to scramble to write them all down right now. They'll be accessed later on the WDTV website.
Okay, great. Thanks.
You're welcome.
Dan, hey, it's Dan Baumgarten in La Crosse.
Hey, how's it going, Dan?
Good. Hey, on your precipitation type, when you do the types for the EC mean, it looked like, and the UK, what algorithm are you using there? You said some background. Do you have any specifics on what algorithm's going on there?
No, I wasn't given the specific methodology, but it's very similar to what we had with the Raymer algorithm, looking at all the different level planetary and level temperatures, and an estimate of how deep and how warm the integrated layer is would determine whether it be sleet or freezing rain.
Okay. Thanks.
Yeah, no problem. Yeah, ideally, it would just be explicitly the precipitation type grids from the UK Met and the European, but we don't get those, and that's another request that I've had for several years running. Okay. Any other questions on operations? Okay. Of course, you can revisit anything later on after the verification section is done. Okay. So time to go into verification. One caveat, we're going to show the verification east of the Rockies, and the rhyme and reason for this is historically forecasters have looked askance at the national verification and have told the developers that our analysis does not correctly capture some of the Intermountain West heavier snow totals, and so we got gaps in the data, and then it hurts the analysis. So the retort from the developers to the forecasters is to show the verification east of the Rockies to show that the trends are true there in the central and eastern part of the country as well as the west. So that's why we do what we do and what's here. We do have a national verification, and so anyone wants to have me send them those, I can do that. So anyway, we're going to alternate the threat scores and the bias to review the performance. And this first one, the threat score evaluation, comparing last year versus this year. So last year, 2010-11 in green. This year, 2011 and 12 there in the orange. And so you can see for our 4, 8, and 12-inch threat scores for the accumulation forecast, the trend is down for all three criteria. And so pretty universally, we didn't have as much skill as measured by the threat score in the forecast. On the earlier conference call on Friday, I was asked if I knew why this was, and no one's done a complete analysis that I've seen as to the reason. A couple different hypotheses to explore would be whether there were fewer events last year than the previous year. A lot of times our threat scores for QPF and winter weather just do better when you have more and more widespread and heavier events. Another avenue that I'd like to see explored is if, say, EMC could evaluate the variability of the forecast. Certain patterns are more predictable than others. Was this just a year in which there was more variability in the guidance and therefore we had less skill at pinpointing what the events were going to be and what the probabilities are? So I don't have an informed opinion, not seeing any analysis of data. Any questions or comments on this threat score verification comparison versus last year? Okay, none heard. And so what we're going to do is alternate between the threat score and the bias. And this is kind of walking you through our forecast process. And so this series of slides, what you see in the yellow is what we call an automated ensemble. It's the consensus of all the different forecast members. And so it's the NAM, the GFS, the European, the 20 SHREF members, and the 20 GEFS members. And it's literally an average of all these different forecasts. What's in the orange is red, what we call the forecaster blend, is what the forecaster runs, whatever combination of these available models and ensembles we choose. On one day, it might be 50% GFS and 50% European. On another day, it might be 30% of two models and 20% of others, whatever combination the forecaster runs on that day. And then the final is what the forecaster edits and then issues after doing the editing of the forecast. And so the automated is kind of your benchmark. You're providing a skillful forecast if you can beat that. And so looking at this year's verification, it seems pretty clear to me the consensus of multiple models and ensembles outperform both our blends and our final edits. And so you can see for 8 inches, the trend is going down as we go and choose our blends and run the edits. So this is actually similar to what we had the year before. So the consensus forecast for day one is very good and very difficult for us to beat. Okay, any questions on this threat score before we go into the bias? Okay, none heard. Here's the bias. Here is our ideal score. Anything that's above one is a high bias. Anything down here is considered to be a low bias. You're not forecasting enough events. And then notice the upward trend as you go up. And so the reason why it's important to show what we got out of the blend was to illustrate that we weren't the source. We don't have forecasters that go wild and start adding high accumulations. We actually able to reduce some of the bias. But since our goal is way down here, it's obvious we didn't reduce the bias enough. And so we got some work to do, both identifying cases in which the models have a high bias and recognizing that and then bringing it down. And notice the automated ensemble has a much better bias, and it suggests that maybe we could effectively reduce the bias by incorporating some of the automated consensus into the forecast. Any questions or comments on this bias diagram?
I have a quick question. Does this account for shifts in snow tracks? So like the 12 inch, if you missed it by like 50 miles, would that account for the real high bias?
My understanding is the bias calculation, since it's done for the whole country, you don't get penalized if it just winds up hitting a different area. And so in our case, we're going to I'm going to show a case later in some of the reliability diagrams that show we just have a little bit too much aerial coverage for our moderate and high risk forecasts, and too much coverage for the higher accumulation thresholds. Okay, any other questions on the threat diagram here? And I mean the bias here. Okay. Let's go on, and this is just switching from day one to day two, and again, it's the threat score for the deterministic forecast east of the Rockies, and here's where the consensus starts falling, and the model blends and the forecasters here are outperforming the automated blend, so the trend is up going from the benchmark to what we produce, an accumulation forecast that we send out to the forecast offices. And so the trend here has been reversed, and we're able to add value on the day two forecast. And so the forecaster blend did improve upon the automated consensus, except for here at 12 inches, where there's a slight reduction in the threat score. And you can see that's around 0.02 or 0.3, so the skill score is getting pretty low for the real heavy snow events. Okay, any questions on the day two threat score before we go into bias? None heard? And so just like on day one, you see the increasing trend in the bias as you go from 4, 8, and 12 inches. And like before, we do a good job in the sense that we are reducing the bias, but it's just not enough. We have to reduce the bias a little bit more from the blends that we're running. One of the questions I got in an earlier seminar regarded some verification, and at the end of the verification subsection here, I'm going to give you a link in that you can look at national and regional QPF scores for this past winter, individual months. And I was looking at this morning and pretty surprised to see in January and February all the different models had a high bias for QPF amounts under 3/4 of an inch. Okay. So here's the day three threat score. And with the increasing spread amongst the ensemble solutions, when you get up to 12 inches, you barely register. So there's a wide enough spread amongst all the different forecasts. You average them all together, and you wind up with a very low score and a rare forecast of a foot. And so and it's pretty close. Here's the blend and the final. They're running practically neck and neck. So the forecasters editing the initial blend aren't really doing that much of to add value to the forecast. And so for us, the key to a successful forecast is to run a good blend. Okay, any questions on the day three threat score before we go to the bias? Okay, here's the bias. Again, here's our benchmark, bias of one. And you can see it's a pretty high and increasing bias as you go towards the higher amounts, so we have to continue to do a better job of reducing. Okay, any questions on the day three bias before we move on? Okay, so we're going to look at the probabilistic snowfall forecast verification. And what we want to do is compare the initial draft continuous probability forecast that's here in the upper right. We get this as our draft forecast, and then we try to edit it. And we're going to see whether, when we get to the final version, we can improve upon that draft forecast. And so we're just going to show side-by-side comparisons of the broader skill scores of the top versus the bottom forecast. Are the forecasters at its improving the forecast reliability or not? So here's the day one prior skill score for the probabilistic forecast. So here's a benchmark, zero. Anything positive shows positive skill. So both the draft continuous forecast and the edited final forecast are showing skill, except for here 12 inches, where the forecaster edits actually degraded the forecast. And so this comparison over all 3 days shows almost an even split between when the forecaster edits improve the probability forecast and when they degrade it. And so this suggests that we don't need to be spending a lot of time editing the multi-model, multi-ensemble probability forecast. Okay, any questions on this prior skill score for day one before we go to day two and day three? Okay, none heard. Here's the same analysis for the day two forecast, the continuous probability forecast here in yellow. And you can see how the prior skill score is only a percent or two difference as we go from the draft to the final forecast that we issue. And then here's the forecast for day three. And so we got in trouble by making edits to the 8 and 12-inch forecast that degraded the probabilities. And so it screams that we don't need to be editing the later out periods on days two and day three. It's very hard to anticipate what the probabilistic trends are going to be later on. Any questions on the Breyer skill score for day three? None heard. Another way of looking at the bias that we have in the forecast is looking at a reliability diagram. So we're going to compare the forecast frequency versus the verifying frequency. And so the numbers here, the 10, 40, and 70% correspond to a low, moderate, and high probability forecast. What we try to do is match error coverage with these percentages. So if you're forecasting your 10% probability, you want to match up with about 10% coverage. For 40% probability, you want to match up with about 40% coverage. And for 70% probability, you want to match up with 70% coverage. And so your ideal forecast curve is here in the orange. That's what you want to match. If you're on this side of the curve, you have a low bias. And if you're on this side of the curve, you have a high bias. And so you can see all these forecasts where we forecast greater coverage than is actually observed. And so, for example, for this 40% criteria, you look up and it matches at around 22% of the areas observed meeting that threshold. And so we're over forecasting. And including both the initial and the final curves here for the 4-inch forecast, there's no significant difference at all between the draft forecast and what we edited and make it final. So we don't improve the reliability at all. The curves are pretty closely matching one another. And so for the 70% forecast, instead of having it observed 70% of the time, it's being observed about 25 to 28% of the time. And so we're over-forecasting the aerial coverage in most of these cases. Okay, any questions here on the reliability diagram? Okay, none heard. And so it's the same pattern. Obviously, you've gotten the message that we have some high bias in the forecast, and so the pattern's just repeated here on day two and then again on the day three forecast. And these are the curves for the 4-inch forecast, and these are the curves for the 8-inch forecast. Okay, any questions on reliability diagrams before we move on? Okay, none heard. Here's an example of the deterministic forecast. And what I want you to do is look at the observed analysis in the lower right, widespread area of heavy snow that occurred from western lower Michigan, northern Illinois, northern Missouri. And what I want you to focus on, the areas outlined in purple are 15 to 18-inch snowfall totals. You can see in isolated locations and little patches there, northeastern Missouri, western Illinois, northern Illinois. And we'll compare them to the series of forecasts. On the left is the super ensemble, or the blend of all different forecasts. The axis and orientation looks pretty good, except the observed is a little bit further north up here in Michigan. But otherwise, axis and orientation is good. But because you're averaging all these amounts, you don't see the little blotches of 15 and 18 inches that were observed. Whereas if you go in the upper right, the blend the forecaster ran that day gave output that looked like this. And so instead of little isolated patches of 15 to 18, the forecasters were widespread 15 to 21 inches of snow. And when the forecaster edited that forecast, you can see in the upper left, they took a shot at adding a 21-inch maximum in west central Illinois that didn't verify. And so you can see an isolated 15 to 18, but I don't see an embedded 21. And you can also see some of the warts in the analysis that Dan and I were discussing when he visited here. This minima here and this minima here look to be artificial to me in this one also. And so that hurts our verification a little bit. But regardless, even if those were captured correctly, you could still see the high bias within the forecast. Any questions or comments about looking at this event and how we forecast it?
Dan, this is Dan in La Crosse again. I'm just curious, like snow, can you say a little bit about those ratios you chose for those cases? Are they all the same for each of those events then?
You mean from each of the forecast techniques?
Well, yeah, you had your three panel there. Yeah, uh-huh. Are you picking the same ratio in all those cases? Or?
Yeah, the ratios are automated. The forecaster doesn't have the ability to pick them.
Okay. And could you give a nutshell version again of the HPC snow ratio choices?
Okay.
Just like a couple sentences on that?
Yeah. The snow ratios are an average of climatology, a fixed 11-to-1 snow ratio, and the rover method run through the NAM and GFS temperature profile outputs and relative humidity profile outputs. And so they're all equally weighted at 25% of the calculation.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, that was the reason why I thought it'd be good to send the grids out to the forecast offices, so if anyone wanted to conduct their own snow ratios, they could take the grids and do that. So if they didn't want to use the fixed ratio in their computation, they could get the rover output straight run through any one model, the NAM or GFS, and not have to worry about the smoothing or the damping down of the average method.
What were the four again?
Oh, okay. The rover method run through the NAM numerical guidance output, the rover method run through the GFS output, climatology, and a fixed 11-to-1 ratio. Okay, any other questions on the accumulation forecast or the ratio forecast? Okay, none heard. We'll look at the low tracks graphics verification. What we're doing for each forecast period, you see in the bottom of the screen, out to 72 hours, we're comparing each of the models and ensemble means and the errors of the positions where the forecast lows to occur. So we're looking at the RMS errors and nautical miles. And for each sequence of years that we go on, we're finding that the consensus techniques work the best. And so the GFS plus the NAM in the dark blue and the GFS plus the European for each of these time clusters is almost universally the better forecast and has lower errors than all the individual models and all the individual ensemble means, including the European ensemble mean. Okay, are there any questions on our low tracks graphic and verification of it? Okay, none heard. So we're going to verify, or we're going to go through a summary of the verification. And so you saw we provide the skillful deterministic snowfall forecast that performed better than the automated ensemble for days 2 and 3, and then the automated ensemble actually did the best, or the consensus forecast did the best on day 1. The probabilistic forecast edits did not improve upon most accumulation thresholds, so this suggests that forecasters probably not spend a lot of time doing editing of the probability forecast. Including the human deterministic forecast improved the continuous probability forecast. So if you did a summary of the verification of the probability forecast that did not include our accumulations, they would actually be less reliable and accurate than if you did include it. So we are helping in that regard. And so you saw now from the operational and ensemble low tracks verification, it's a blend of the operational GFS and European forecast for the cyclone positions that outperforms each of the individual models and ensemble means. And one of the comments I got in the conference call on Friday is it's useful to be able to go over verification. And so this EMC webpage allows you to look at the individual models and their threat scores and their biases. You can choose each month of the year. And then you can also choose the section of the country you're in to look at the individual biases because there are variances from one part of the country to the other. Okay, any questions on the verification summary? Okay, none heard. So anything that comes up after the conference call and you think, oh, I should ask Dan this, go ahead and give me a call. This is our new operations number. So you want to call and ask a question about QPF or medium range, model diagnostics, the MetWatch, any subject of operational concern. This is the number, and they'll transfer you to me. And also, we're going to have a new conference call number. And listen to here from now. And again, I've given this to all the forecasters, so everybody will have it whenever we need to have a conference call. This is the number that we'll use, and that's the WFO passcode. So if you want to coordinate or send somebody in the media to talk to us, go ahead and use that number for operational coordination for any and all HPC operations. And that was just an example of the verification from February 2012, the bias scores. Remember, through each of these different forecasts, we had a high bias. And so here's the bias of 1. And you can see all the models clustering well above 1 for the lower threshold scores. Yeah, here's half an inch. And right about 3/4 of an inch on up, you start getting into lower bias. So from 1 inch on up, you got a low bias in the QPF scores. Okay, so that's the summary of our operations changes related to winter weather. And so wanted to pause for a second. Are there any other questions related to winter weather desk operations before I go over the remaining slides on other desks? Okay, anything else that comes up afterward, go ahead and chime in. So I'll just spend a couple of minutes going over some changes on other desks, and then we'll pass it back to Brad so he can talk about the winter weather AWOC training. In response to us not having a good fit for the forecast offices, many of whom do nighttime medium range forecasts, we decided to start issuing the forecast on the night shift. The preliminary proposal is to try to shoot for us issuing the medium range forecast in the HPC guide grids by around 6C or so every day. And so we'll just have to see whether or not that proposal is approved and implemented. And so that involves all the temps and pops relative to humidity and sky cover forecast. In addition to that, right now when we issue the days 4 and 5 QPF, the deadline is 11:30 Z, and that gets bumped back several hours to the middle of the night shift. And on top of that, we're also going to issue a day 6 and 7 QPF forecast starting on December 2012. And so days 6 and 7 was produced the last couple of years as an experiment for Western region, and they wanted to be made operational. So we had done it in the fall and winter, and then we discontinued during the summer. And so we're going to expand this to include all the lower 48 states and do it all year round. And the forecasts are going to be available to everybody in six-hour resolution. Yeah, any questions on the medium range and QPF changes that are coming up? None heard. And also for those areas that are impacted by tropical cyclone rainfall, we're just producing a graphic. It's a QPF that's the same on the other pages, but it zoomed into the area of interest. And so this got a lot of hits for decision support type briefings at national headquarters. And also, we ran an experiment this summer that ended September 15th in which we're proposing to take over the heavy rain aspects of the mesoscale discussions that are now provided by the Storm Prediction Center. And so if everything goes through as planned, we'll start these probably on the order of January 2013. We're still gathering input from the forecast offices as to how effective our experiment was. We had proposed to transfer the heavy snow portion of the mesoscale discussions, and SPC is elected to keep those for now. And so right now we're just going to be doing the heavy rain. The desk we have that does the model diagnostics is going to cut back to two issuances per day instead of four, and then spend the balance of the time looking at doing mesoscale graphics and discussions for heavy rainfall. Does anybody have any questions on how we're going to do the heavy rainfall net watch? Okay, none heard. And I think that's what I wanted to show. Just wanted to give kind of like an executive overview level of the changes that we're going to have. And so that was that presentation. So I wanted to open up the floor and see if any questions anybody has on our winter weather desk operations, verifications, or the upcoming operational changes. This is just a display of the EMC precipitation skill score page. You can just see the menu of all the different options that are available. And so it was nice to display this. And it also does include the CONUS nested NAM that I wanted to see how it compares and contrasts. So go ahead and look at the bias and how the changes from one part of the contract to the other in your area of interest. So that's what I had and what I had planned to show. Any other questions or comments before Brad takes it over and talks about the training schedule? Okay, nothing heard. Brad, are you there?
Yes.
Yeah, well, go ahead and take over, and I guess the people can chime in with questions with me later on, email, call, whatever they feel like, but that's what I had planned to present.
Well, thanks, Dan.
Well, thanks for gathering all the people together and the invitations and for agreeing to host this. I know it took a lot of work on your part, and I'm just thrilled to have so many offices on to participate.
Well, speaking of the offices, I do want to do a real quick count of the registrants on the GoToMeeting and just remind folks again that this is the second webinar. We're going to do one final one this Friday at 9 a.m. Central Time, in which case we will record it and post it on the AWOC Winter website. So the AWOC Winter website is listed up here. You can get to it pretty easily if you go to the AWOC main website. And some news about AWOC Winter before we do the head count. This is the first year in 6 years we're not unable to update the course because it was unfunded in the FY13 implementation plan. And so what we're trying to do for FY, this upcoming year is to do some webinars like Dan has presented and also provide some links to some of the existing courses. And also, if you have any materials that you would like to share, in particular the use of dual pole radar with now casting precipitation type, that type of thing, I think would be really great to share in lieu of a course that needs to be updated. And we're pretty much at this point now where, you know, the funding for a lot of these training courses depend upon regional prioritization. Your SSD chiefs have to prioritize winter weather training and give it a pretty high priority for it to be resourced. And so if you go to this web page, we will list the lessons that may need minor revisions and then those that are out of date. If you do take a lesson this year, for next year, the credit will transfer unless the course is out of date, at which point when we do have a chance to update these modules, including the simulations, then they won't transfer. So I've recommended to people that want to have some of their people take these as refresher training to go ahead and do it, but just be aware that we're not going to be issuing any certificates this year. It's all going to be done locally. So anyway, this is where we'll put Dan's recorded presentation, and again, want to thank him again for taking the time to do this, and also your participation is sure appreciated. I got a lot of people on this list, and what I'll do just to kind of verify the numbers is run down the alphabetized list of the registrants and just confirm you're here. Brad Bramer?
Here.
All right, Buffalo, I heard you chime in.
Three here from Buffalo.
Thank you. Al Cope?
Here, two.
Hey. Here in Mount Holly, we had six.
Mount Holly had six. Okay, thank you. Rob Cox? Okay, no, Rob. Lee Crowley at the ABRFC?
We had four, and we also had one participant from the WFO here in Tulsa.
From Tulsa. Okay, thank you. John Denman. You know John Denman. John Dumas? None heard. Scott Dummer? Donald Dumont? Okay, we had several D's there. How about a Todd Foisey?
Yeah, Todd was here.
Todd, okay. Randy Graham?
Yeah, just one here in Salt Lake, Brad. Thank
you,
Ann.
Thank you. Dean Hazen? Jeff Hovis?
Yeah, just one, Brad.
Thank you. Aaron Johnson?
Hi, Brad. We had 10 here in Dodge.
Thank you. Very great. Wow, that's a record. Mark Kavinsky?
We had 5 here in Milwaukee.
5 in Milwaukee, okay. Steve Caton?
Steve just stepped out of the room, but we had 2 in Blacksburg.
Thank you. Melissa Kreller?
We have 3.
Thank you. Lisa Kreiderman. Kreiderman?
Yep, it's Kreiderman, and yes, just one myself here.
Where are you located, Lisa?
Out of the Boulder office, but I'm actually joining in from home, so I'm not sure.
Okay, so you're representing Boulder. Okay. Anybody else from Boulder attend today? Okay, John Kwiatkowski, Indianapolis.
1 from Indy.
Very good. Ed Ray. Ed?
6 from Jackson.
6 from Jackson. Thank you. Mark Singer.
7 in Billings.
Thank you. Paul Sisson.
4 here in Burlington.
Thank you. Chris Smalcom. Western Region, Reno. Oh, no Chris. Mike Stavish.
Just 1.
Thank you. John Stopcock?
Yep, we had 9 here in North Platte, Brad.
9 in North Platte, thank you. Very good. Page 2, Andrew Taylor.
4 in Flagstaff, Brad.
Thank you. Richard Wagamaker. Dick Wagamaker. No, Dick Wagamaker. Okay. Jeremy Wisely.
Hey, Brad, we had 5 here at Hastings.
5 in Hastings, thank you. Ray Wolf?
We had 6 here at the Quad Cities, Brad.
Thank you. DVN. Paul Wolin?
8 here from Pueblo.
8 in Pueblo. And Charlie Woodrum. That's Tampa, I believe, right?
No, 1 in Pittsburgh.
1?
Yep, just 1.
Thank you. Anybody else that registered that I didn't call out?
Yeah, Brad. Chris here in Little Rock. We had 3.
Chris, Little Rock, LZK3. Okay.
Brad, this is Mary at Pendleton, and we had 3.
Mary at Pendleton, PDT3, okay?
We had 4 in Taunton.
4 in Taunton.
We had a total of 4 up in Caribou, by the way.
4 in Caribou, okay.
5 in Midland.
5 in Math, okay.
2 in Aberdeen.
Two in Aberdeen. A lot of late arrivals. Okay. Anything? Anybody else?
Hanford, we had nine.
Hanford?
Yep, nine.
Wow, okay. Very good.
Five in Wichita.
Thank you.
One in Riverton, Brad.
One in Riverton. Thank you.
Hey, all right, Brad, Paul in Silver Spring, one.
Paul, all right. Paul Stokels, all right, thank you. All right, be looking for an email, follow-up email on the webinar, just kind of confirm the numbers, and again, appreciate your attendance, and be looking for this website, and we'll, that's where we'll post the presentation. We'll do the recorded webinar, and also Dan's going to do a recorded articulate that we're going to put as part of the FY13 Winter Weather Track, basically adding on some of the stuff that's in IC21 Products and Services. All right, thanks a lot, everybody. Have a great winter. Danny still there? He's gone. All right, I'll talk to him later. All right.
But I'm still here. The leader has disconnected. This call will now end.